Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Okay, I'll start at the beginning then. I was born in UTH. So, clear that up. I went to Nkwazi school. Then from there, I went to boarding school. First in Botswana, then in England. I finished boarding school, A-levels in England, university in England, and then I started work. But the intention was always I had a few years to absorb some extra knowledge and then come back to Zambia, just like my brother, who did the same thing.
So you only have a brother?
One
just
brother.
The two of you?
It's two of us.
You're the older one?
I'm the older one. Oh. Well, yes. He's a more mature one. I'm the older one.
Okay, so from your profile, Eric, that you pursued, you worked as a banker. Maybe you can just explain what motivated you to get into the banking sector.
Well, I started work when I was 20. So I finished my degree. I came home for a few months and then was sent off to work. I had actually wanted to go to the US, but my parents were not keen. They were both at Oxford University and Bristol before that, and they wanted me to finish in the British system. So when I finished university, I wanted to go to the US, but my brother, who was studying engineering, chemical engineering at Imperial, he said, no, just stay in London, and when I finish, you can go. So I decided, what most 20-year-olds do is, where do I find the money? And the easiest way to learn that is inside a bank. So I had a very shallow motivation for going into banks. I wanted to see where people made money.
We all have some form of motivation, and I think when we're young, we can relate to the making money first.
Yeah.
Yeah. So how long then did it take before you came back to Zambia?
Well, I was 2 years in Zambia. I mean in London, 2.5 years. And then I was transferred to India for a year with the same bank. As I say, I picked up my favorite souvenir, my wife. I found mentor in India. I went back to London, Kenya, and then Zambia. So I was working for a total of maybe 4 years, just under 4 years, outside Zambia. Then I came back with Grimley's Bank, ANZ Grimley's at the time, which is now Stanbic Bank. So that was my return route, but the objective was always to come back.
So when did the entrepreneurship journey start? Did it start while you were working?
Well, it's a question I'm always asked about. Do you wish you had started earlier? And you always try and do a few things. And it's a question of where you start saying, where's your entrepreneurship journey start? And I suppose it always starts when you're working. And I think that's what everyone forgets, is that work is an environment where you're paid to learn. You're not in a work environment being paid. You know, all too often in Zambia, the issue is, I'm not paid to do that, so I'm not going to do that, I'm not going to consider that. And the only person you're harming is actually yourself. The story I always tell about this is actually my brother's story, is when he got back from his chemical engineering, after a year of working for ZCCM, I think his gross salary in dollar terms was $100. I did slightly better when I came back in 92, he came back in 91. When I came back in 92, my net salary was $110, so I was much richer as a manager in the bank. But he was a salesman, a lubricant salesman at Mobil Oil. And he would work all the way through to 5, selling to maximize his sales time, get back to the office at 5, do his paperwork. Now again, another Zambian rush hour habit is, of course, if you're a salesperson, you've got to get back into the office by 16, 15, 30, finish your paperwork, get ready, 17 hours, you're gone. His ethic was, let me maximize my sales, and I'll come back, do my paperwork, and then go home. So he drove around in his little Hyundai XL until 17 hours. And the only other person who was left in the building after 17 hours, another Zambian trait, was the MD. And the MD one day was preparing board papers. And my brother, 22, I think at the time, 22 I think it was, he turned around and said, "Can I help you with your board papers?" So he quickly started getting involved in preparing the board papers. And then asked, again, completely outside what he was paid to do. He was paid to sell lubricants. But this is how he learned, by doing extra overtime, after hours. And very soon he was invited into the board meetings in case he had questions on some of the things that he had prepared. So fast forward to 3 years ago, he was appointed as the private sector representative, the ZFE, Zambia Federation of Employers, representative on the NAPSA board. Now I can't help see the correlation that this young 22-year-old trying to learn more about board meetings then gets appointed 20, 30 years later onto Zambia's largest entity. I think it's worth $3 billion or something. So it's important that your entrepreneurial journey starts when you start working. That's where you learn. That's where you learn all these extra things. That's where, if you're an engineer, you've got an opportunity to learn accounting. You've got an opportunity to learn about HR. All of these skills is what you need to get into your entrepreneurial space at a later date. So when you ask me when my entrepreneurial journey started, it really started when I was 20, when I started working. Actually, I started working when I was 17 in my holidays, but full-time, well, that was part-time. Full-time until I was 20. So that's really, for me, is the importance of employment. So should I have started what I'm starting now in 1992? Yeah, I would have loved to, but I didn't have the skill sets. I didn't have the understanding. And without that skill set, without that understanding, without that track record, I wouldn't have been able to start what I've started now. Investors wouldn't have confidence. I wouldn't have the ability. So they're very intertwined, as people see them as very separate. I'm employed, and then I go to Tamanga. No, it doesn't matter.
So I guess the key thing that you're saying is having a regular job is a good thing, because that's like our training ground before we transition into being self-employed. So I would then ask you, when did you actually set up your own company? When did you start working on your own business?
Well, just quickly to highlight this, employment does two things. It gives you training, it gives you exposure, but it also gives you an ability to build up some equity. You need money to start a business, and you need money to carry yourself through the first few years of your business. Now, if you're a good saver, which I'm not, you put it in the bank and don't touch it. If it's in the bank, it's gone with me. So I had to put it into property. As soon as I got something, some money, part of my salary, I overextended myself. I built properties so I could try. That would carry me through. That would be the rental income from those would carry me through the lean years, which is what it did. And it took a long time to build up that equity. So employment does two things. It helps you build yourself up so you can get some static income or some saving so that you can carry through when you jump ship, when you turn from gamekeeper to poacher. I did that formally 8-9 years ago now.
So you saved enough for how many years? Because you mentioned to say it helps you have the equity you need to transition.
Well, really, from the beginning, I suppose it was a bit difficult when you're on $110 gross net. It's a bit difficult to save at that point. But moving through banks, I was at Meridian, and then I was at Barclays, and then I was with a consulting firm called DCDM. We represented Arthur Anderson and Accenture, big into global brands. And so all during that period, I was trying to save and build. At night sometimes I'd do extra consulting so that I could get extra money to accelerate building.
So from the profile also, I saw that you had about three ventures running. There's Western Powers, there's the Memorial Park, and there's another one, Leopards Hill.
Well, Leopards Hill Development was the first one I started, and it was a property development out in Leopards Hill Road. And again, our objective with that development wasn't necessarily to make lots of money, which we didn't, but it was to try and prove that we could do a development separately. We had two large pieces of land, 300 acres each, and we split two of them up, we developed them, we built tar roads, we put in water systems, we put in gatehouses, and rather than doing the traditional getting a plot of land, subdividing it, putting a grader through and selling your plots and walking away, we decided that we needed to add value, not just for the profitability side. We knew that would be difficult, and we were correct, but more for the reputation. So it would build our reputation that we were able to do, handle large developments, international capital coming in, paying it back, so that people saw that we had a track record. And that was the most valuable part. But as we weren't really earning in that part, it was also very valuable that I'd had some static income to pay school fees and buy conflicts. So these are, I was able to take that risk because I'd done enough to carry me through. If it was, if I didn't have that, then I'd have a real problem. I need to make money to live. And then that makes you, you can't take bigger decisions. You can't say, okay, I'm going to do this for strategic reasons rather than because I need the money. I need to start selling plots next month. If you're putting in all of this additional infrastructure, it takes you a long time to get those plots going.
So how do you decide then which business venture to get into? Interestingly enough, you've gone into Western Power, especially, yeah. I think it's at the right time, looking at what we're going through. Could you just tell us a bit about Western Power?
Okay. Western Power is, we started it probably about 7 years ago. And probably 80% of our time on Western Power over the last 4 to 5 years spent. So 4 or 5 years ago, power wasn't as topical as it is now, but it was as obvious as it is now. ZESCO were clearly stating, this is what's going to come, we need to invest, we need to increase tariffs. They were asking for tariff increases. So it was very obvious, if you looked at the whole of Southern Africa, that power was going to become a problem. So that was part of the decision that it made sense. Business is about, Richard Branson was here, he said it's about a need. What is your need? Memorial Park, I didn't grow up thinking, oh, I went on a cemetery. but a need arose, and it was my late grandfather and our late adopted brother, Yuma Tembo, were buried in the old council cemetery. And the graves were being vandalized. It was just chaos. And so I had a need. I wanted to move them and put them into a small family plot. Enough was enough. But we then found a plot of 80 acres. Now, it's there are lots of pyramids, but not that many. So my idea then was, if I need it, then everyone else will need it. And so it's about looking at need. That's what's going to drive your product to success. Need, differentiation. We weren't the first private cemetery. There was already Mutumbi here. So you have to go through your logic tree. You have to test your assumption. It's not just about what you, oh, I might need this. You have to then dive much further. And again, my experience, risk analysis in banks, credit risk, watching businesses, that all helped me assess how this could work and raise the money. Memorial Park, for instance, was $5 million to develop. A lot of people felt, oh, yeah, great idea, just get a piece of land, you cut it up, and it's far more complex than that. And the hardest part is raising the money. So with that, again, it built our credentials to, as we were working on the technical side, of the power project. We were running them in parallel, pretty much. We we then had the credibility of being able to raise money and service that debt or equity successfully. And that then helped us raise, because the next leap was Western Power. Western Power is a $220 million project. So raising that much amount of money, actually ironically it's easier to raise that amount of money rather than the smaller amounts. People come queuing in. But timing has been fortunate for us in terms of this current crisis. There's a bit more momentum. But 5 years is a long time at idea stage, building the product. And our hope is that in about a year's time, we start construction. Construction will be 2 to 3 years. And then you've got another probably 10 years of debt to pay back at 200 million. So these are long-term projects, are big projects. And they never seem as glamorous as people think they are, but it's identifying what they are. I have interests in IT, Net1 and NetData. I'm its first multi-tenanted tier 3 data center. So opportunities here, we actually are very fortunate. We live in the last economic frontier of planet Earth. And we are one of the best places to be in that last frontier. But it requires a lot more discipline and skill to exploit that. We always talk about this curse word, potential. But potential is only realized when people apply themselves and the discipline and the sacrifice that's needed to jump that. And it's years and years of preparation, both in training, both in savings, both in testing your ideas. You know, you've got a new app and you go to someone and say, what do you think? Your friends are going to tell you, it's great, it's great. It requires far more thinking, far more detail to get into that. Most business plans I look at, be a millionaire in year 2. Doesn't work like that.
So you talked about international income, having a proven track record, having been a banker. I hear a lot of SMEs complain about access to finance. What advice would you give someone who's starting out or someone who's struggling in that area? Especially that I'm seeing figures like 200 million, who would just trust you with money like that?
Well, again, it's how you build up that track record. You know, your first $100,000, your first $50,000, your first dollars, quite, it doesn't matter what the currency is. Your first raise is always the most difficult raise. And it's not always from the banks. I think people, access to capital, there's no doubt, is a problem in Zambia. It's a big, big problem. Government effectively crowds us out. Today, on the way here, I heard the Minister of Finance increasing the ceiling on domestic borrowing. A bank, why lend to Sipho Phiri? Why? I mean, who are you? I can lend to the government. There's no credit analysis. There's no asking for your accounts. I give them, I get treasury bills, I get my money back, I've got a sovereign guarantee. Finished. It's much easier. And you go and look at all the bank's results every quarter they publish them. That's what they do. They're treasury bill lending operations. So we can blame the banks, we can blame the government, we can blame whoever we want. The issue is we've got to overcome that constraint. Now, my favorite story on this is the richest man in the world and the most successful venture capitalist on planet Earth was the person who first put money into Bill Gates. Now, Bill Gates, having had a product with IBM, the largest company in the world, I think, at the time, couldn't raise money to produce his Windows operating system. He couldn't raise it from banks, from anybody else. This is in the United States. This is in the computer industry. And he couldn't raise his money. So he went around shopping, just like we would all have to do. Shop, going around, begging, asking, convincing, being chased, come tomorrow. And eventually, his grandmother gave him $50,000 and her garage to say, go, my boy, and that's all my money, but I'm sure you want. His parents wouldn't even have lent him. It was his grandmother who became the most successful investor on planet Earth. So we mustn't pretend that it's someone is going to come and give it to us, or it's someone else is responsible to make it easy. It's not. From $50,000 for Bill Gates to $200 million for Western Power, it doesn't really make a difference. Your issue is you've got to have the credibility, and you've got to have, and to get that, you have to have the experience, the detail, and the tough skin to hear everyone chasing you. Power was the same thing with us. What do you people know about power? You know, we just were not interested. But you had to keep going, and then they start seeing your detail, and they start seeing your plans, and then they start saying, well, and the first people who gave us a shot were Development Bank of South Africa. They gave us $350,000. And that was a big break, because then suddenly everyone was saying, well, if they've given, then maybe we can look at this a bit closer. You always have to find that one. So, raising capital is a problem. We've all got to face it, and we mustn't whinge about it. You just got to find a way around it. And either it's you, and you're safe, you're diligent in your employment, you get good bonuses. Another thing I like to say about our work culture in Zambia, which I'm guilty of, but I found a way of addressing it, not our work culture, but our ethic in terms of savings. How to save for equity and save for the future. China is a bit worried. Their saving rates have fallen, I think, to about 52%. So you're making 10,000, 5,000 kwacha a month. In China, they save over 2,500 kwacha every month, and they spend 2,500 kwacha. In Zambia, and then you get your big promotion, and you move from 5,000 kwacha to 10,000 kwacha. In Zambia, that means your expenditure that month, even before you get your first pay, from 5,000 to 11,000. In China, automatically, it will be a minimum of 5,000 of saved for the increase. Now you add up, if everyone here adds up throughout their working career, short or long, if you had saved half of everything you'd earned, how much would you have in your pocket now to start a business? You wouldn't be crying about capital. So there's a way, and it's not someone else's responsibility, it's ours. So either you overcome it, or you don't. And you stay earning 10,000 and spending 11, it's fine. So that's what you're comfortable with.
I like that, that's very good, good advice right there. So, in terms of, you know, you obviously have goals, visions for the companies that you're involved in. How easy is it to get human resource, and do you experience challenges with people trying to achieve your goals, or what do you do to ensure that people actually
Well, I shouldn't really be talking about that. An expert is in the room, but then, the issue is attitude. Really, it boils down to attitude. What's people's attitude to work? And it's a struggle to get people to have the right attitude. We recently employed a young electrical engineer, Zambian, and his father left in 1990, around there, and he was educated outside, and he wanted to come back to Zambia, so we gave him an opportunity. Often I'll find him in the office at 10, 11 at night, working on sorting out tender documentations, working on drawings, working on these things. And I wonder to myself, is it this Zambian boy? Is it because he's educated overseas? Or is it, if he was here in our system, same chap, would he be working at 10, 11 at night with no one asking him to do so? No complaints, no nothing. I even had to ask him the other day, are you actually working, or are you online or something else? Because I've become so skeptical, and it's all about the attitude. And I think everyone here knows it. We have a problem with attitude. We have a problem with working for people, we have a problem with integrity, and we have this attitude of entitlement. The employer owes me, the government owes me, And it's not true, it's not right. You're there for yourself. I worked for people for over 20 years. I never once felt I worked for someone. Never once. Yes, I had to ask for leave. Yes, I had to come in at certain hours. I've done all of that. Yes, I had to make coffee. That's not my issue. I didn't feel I was working for someone else. My attitude was, I'm working for myself. And this is my conduit. This is my conduit towards. Someone's paying me to learn? Great. When you go to university, well, conception here sometimes, you pay to go to university. You pay to learn. At least someone pays for you. But you are now an opportunity where someone can. We don't have that attitude here, as a generality. Of course, there are many exceptions. But as a generality, that's not what it is. People don't have that. And the new buzzword now, and you read Harvard Business Review and all of these things, is employers are looking for people with owner's mentality. That owner's mentality is a big issue. And I suppose, for me, looking back now, I've read this buzzword, this is what I had. But my ownership wasn't of Barclays Bank. My ownership was of Sipho Phiri. I'm here, I'm working for my benefit. Yes, you give me a salary at the end of the month. Yes, I want more salary. But I will extend myself to make sure I maximize profits. Even just to keep the institution I'm working for, the consulting firm. I had to work, because if the money didn't come into the firm, then I wouldn't get paid. So, and I needed that money at the end of the month. So, a lot of people said, oh, but you owned it. No, I didn't. I was an employee like everybody else. But it's just an ethic, and that's the biggest issue here. And it's the biggest issue that harms people in their transition from gamekeeper, employment, to poacher, to a manga life.
So you've mentioned some very, very good challenges that we experience right now in our country, integrity and so forth. From your personal journey, what would you say has been the biggest challenge?
It's a long list of them. The biggest challenge is credibility. You know, a lot of people, as I said, my brothers, the more mature one, the more serious one, a lot of people have always questioned my ability, my seriousness. And so that, I suppose, has been the biggest issue, trying to prove to people that, no, I can do it. And the only way to do that is effort, detail. If you don't have the attention to detail, people very quickly puncture what you've got to do. But once they start seeing success and ability, then, and reputation. So you can go back all the way to Grindy's Bank, short staffing bank in 1992, and find people I worked with and bump into them. You must never underestimate how people bump into each other and say, oh, that chap, oh, okay. No. When he was working at that bank, he wanted something on the side. But if they say, no, that guy really looked after me, I like him. 20 years later, that person will be talking to a financier who's about to give you $5 million, $10 million. By coincidence, sitting on an aeroplane. Do you know this guy, Sipho Phiri? And you are the one who's in charge of that integrity. You're the one who has to keep it all the way through. You're the one, every little interaction. Yes, there's some people are going to get things wrong and misunderstand it, but 90% of the people that you meet, they must understand what your position is. And if your position is you've done a quick thing on the side, and then next thing, you know, you've taken a cut here, the person actually giving you that cut is going to be the same person talking to a financier and saying, hey, that guy. So it wasn't the product, it was what's the passion of the person. And I read last year sometime that moving from employment to manga life, to entrepreneurship, is really the equivalent of being paid by someone to work 40 hours a week to not being paid and working 80 hours a week. And that's the fact. You have to work that much harder. You're not getting paid. It's a struggle in the beginning. And that's a very difficult balance. And the only way you're going to be able to get through those 80 hours a week of not being paid is if actually what you're doing doesn't feel like work. If you hate what you're doing, there's no way you're going to make it. You know, most people say their motivation is money. Money doesn't really motivate you to work 80 hours a week. What motivates you is something deeper. So my motivations are my family, especially my children, and my country. That's what motivates me. Is it going to be better for them? There are many things, many opportunities that I've come across, which I just wouldn't be able to put that effort into. I wouldn't. And I know I won't succeed if that effort doesn't go into. So I've just said, no, thank you. So you've got to be able to find out what that is. But at the same time, you've got to keep yourself alive. So it's ironic that my heart attacks came primarily as a result of my stress working for someone. But again, it was all part of my learning curve, finding that balance.
What's the one thing you're most proud of as an entrepreneur?
Well, most of my pride comes from where there's been an improvement to Zambia, or I've been able to improve people's lives, or improve people's outlooks, or give people belief. I remember a proud moment with the cemetery was with my uncle, Manasseh Phiri. I don't know if you know. And I met Manasseh just before he was at a function. He was going off to the White House to get some award. And he said, yeah, I've got to confess something to you. I said, confess? It's a strong word. He said, yeah, you know, all these years, and I think it was only last year that this happened, or the year before, but he said, I've been embarrassed and ashamed of you. Okay. He says, you're making money from the dead. And I said, well, actually, technically, that's not correct. I don't ever charge the dead. So. I understand where you're coming from. He says, but for the first time, I went to a funeral. And, you know, it was dignified, and it was peaceful, and it was becoming of the person that was being buried. And so many people at that funeral came to me and thanked me and said, you know, thank you, you know, please thank your nephew. And I was telling them I supported him all the way. But really, the pride comes from that. It's achieved that very thing which I personally needed. And it achieved that for Zambia. It's a small step, but for people to be able to come, if I'm driving out in the evening and I can see, you know, a woman unafraid to go and sit next to a loved one, you know, people to come and pay respects. It's our culture is to pay respects to our ancestors. It's very embedded in our culture. Well, the westernized culture is beginning to erode that. So those are the type of things that give me pride, an ability to show that there's an improvement. So maybe a short antidote on that one is, I remember listening on the radio, there was this argument about public sector can't do anything and the private sector can do anything. And then someone came up with this issue about the cemetery as an example. Look at the council cemeteries, they're finished, there's confusion. But the private cemetery right next door is operating very well. So I thought, oh, that's nice. And then he said, but the problem is it's not about public and private. It's us Zambians who can't do anything. It's the Muzungus who are being able to do anything. And I thought, oh, should I call in now? The next next caller called and said, nothing, it's not Muzungus, it's Zambians who run that thing. And that was a point of pride. Because it is, you go there, it's run completely by Zambians. Financed by Muzungus, it's fine. The whole point was, is it hopefully inspire people that we want a better standard, and it's our responsibility to deliver a better standard. So those are the type of things.
Okay, so we'll open it up to the audience. As they're thinking through, you can just raise your hand. Someone will bring a mic to you.
You said that your working years were your learning years, your learning curve, and your experience. And you know, becoming an entrepreneur, there's so many things you have to learn in the journey. I just wanted to find out, were there any books or particular sources of information where you personally delved into? And what do you think are some of the most important sources for a young entrepreneur for information?
You have more access to information on the phone in your pocket than I did in 1990. I keep a set of Encyclopedia Britannica at my house, and occasionally I take my children and say, this is my Google. And they say, well, what do you mean? They've seen these books their whole life. They've been always looking at them. I said, okay, go and look up frog. And so they have to get the books, and they have to go and look for F, and then half an hour later they say, come on, you know, we can do it in 3 seconds on the phone. So I generally am too tired to read books. I fall asleep very quickly. But I do read articles, you know, there are many from, you know, all over, Harvard Business Reviews. There are many articles. You just need to Google and then pull those together. But information is very crucial. Information to help you, everything from your business plan to your strategies. I'll guarantee you, I mean, another thing we get very secretive about in Zambia is our ideas. No. If I tell you, no. I'll guarantee you I can Google your idea and I'll find 1,000 others of those. So your idea is not going to be a breakthrough in Zambia or in the world. But you can make it. As I said, with our cemetery, we weren't the first cemetery. But what were the key issues? We had location. And when you talk about the cemetery, we have two sides. We have the social side, but then you have the business side. I had people put in $5 million. So I've got to be thinking of those issues. So you've got to look at what are those issues? How does that return get back to the investors? Because if it dents it, it dents the rest of my life. So that detail is found in reading. It's found in research. And now you're more fortunate that you can have bite-sized research. You can go and find the specific on something. You can download a book and read that specific paragraph that is relevant to you. So information is very important. Research is very important. And comparing that, and how does it apply to you, and how does it apply to your dear. But ultimately, also talking to people who've been through that curve. You do. You come take the time, you come sit by my fireplace and we talk. So that's the important thing, because someone will test you. Perhaps the most important input is criticism, is disbelief, is Manasseh Phiri saying, because when you're able to face that, we're able to counter that criticism, then you're now on the right track. We get offended by criticism. Someone comes and sits with you and says, this is my idea, and the response is, ah, that's useless. You're offended, eh? No. Actually, that's the person you need to start really saying, why is it useless? You need to start getting that criticism, and if you can't answer the questions, then you go and research. Maybe your product will fail. And that's where products fail, the lack of research, the lack of attention to detail. But you have all that information right now.
You mentioned earlier that staff, basically, for you, for your business. I'm wondering in terms of how you basically recruit, identify, recruit and retain staff that are buying into your vision for your businesses. And then in addition to that, obviously to attain the successes that you managed to get over your business life, you had to be driven. Have you had any mentors and that sort of thing, basically to help you, to keep you in the on the straight and narrow as you attain your goals?
Again, in our cultural tradition, we're fortunate is that we believe in the elders. And I do. I spend the time, if I've got time, I go and visit. I visit elders, I talk to them, I get their ideas, I hear their boring lectures, I hear them, you know, their complaints. But actually, you gain a lot in terms of experience, of history. And in fact, the Power Project came from exactly that idea. I was coming back from a farm visit as a banker in Chisamba, and I stopped off at an old man, and he said, yeah, you know, I'm going to die soon. I said, come on, you're spring chicken. No, don't be stupid, I'm going to die soon. I said, well, what regrets do you have? And he said, actually, hold on. And he got up, he went off, came back with all these old maps, and said, the one thing I really wanted to do for is build this power station in Western Province. And I'm thinking, really? He says, but now I'm fine, because I know you'll do it. I said, I don't know anything about it. I don't know how to do that. He said, no, here, you. And so his son is one of the partners in this business. And so mentorship comes in many ways. In terms of keeping me on the straight and narrow, my parents were very crucial in that, because this issue of integrity and bringing embarrassment or shame to the family is a very big issue. I still would fear. My father passed away a few years ago, but I still fear a knock on the ceiling later tonight. So there are many things that... there are many resources like that available. And we're fortunate that the people in many positions, very high, lofty positions, they are very happy to talk to you. You go around in the evening, sit with them. They're very happy to do that. So I've taken advantage of that. In terms of staffing and buying provision, it's very difficult. The thing I suppose I've learned over time is this issue of instilling responsibility. And once responsibility is instilled in the staff, that it's their responsibility. If something goes wrong, it's you. If you crash the car, then either you make sure that everything is insured, everything's done, you bring the money back, or I'll take it from you. Believe me, there's nothing more that crystallizes a sense of responsibility than when you are the one who has to pay. But you are responsible. Now, if you're not responsible, then sure, insurance will pay. But if you want to leave your tools lying around and throw them as you run for the gate at 17 hours, and those tools are pencils and computers just as much as a shuffle, then, you know, you have to have that sense of responsibility. So people know, I don't take that sense of irresponsibility lightly. Once you're responsible, then I'll empower you. I've taken many, many people from, you know, from working in the garden to running my businesses. So I've no problem with that. I've got no problem with people learning the hard way. You just have to show that you will apply yourselves. And I think we, again, it's the other big issue that we all know about, PhD, Zambian speciality. And I don't have an issue with that. For me, the more Zambians that succeed, the better for all of us, and certainly the better for my children. Forbes magazine once gave me a call through some point, saying, Do I know anyone who could be on the cover of Forbes Worldwide, for example? I said, well, what's the criteria? They said, no, someone for Zambia will lower the limit, but you know, $100 million and above, which can they can show that they've been taxed on. I said, go to Zimbabwe. So we need that. We need that. We need to. We thrive on the more people that are successful, the better we will all be. So if I can contribute to someone being successful, I'll be very happy to do it. And those of my staff who understand that and have seen the examples of people I've taken, you know, some, the IT entity NetOne and then Data, I started with that boy when he was 16 years old. And he now owns, you know, technically a multi-million dollar company. But it's better for all of us. So, you know, if everyone can have that attitude and everyone can understand that, then fine. But I think those of my staff who know that that's my ethos is I want people to succeed. I'm very happy for people to come and tell me, as long as again, not, my grandmother's sick in the village, but because I got another job somewhere else. Come and tell me, I'll even advise you. Listen, you know, that's a good job, you should take it. Because it will progress people. There's no point in holding people back. It harms us. I hope that answers it.
My question is, I'm going to play devil's advocate for a bit. What do you say to the cynic? Not that I'm the cynic, but what do you say to the cynic who obviously say to you, well, look, you seem to have had a privileged background. If you were able to go to school in the United Kingdom, attend Bristol or Oxford, I don't know which one it was. What do you say to that person who's going to come and say, look, I haven't had that opportunity. I come from John Lane compound and I cannot afford to save half of my salary. I have to look after 20 other people, but I want to be an entrepreneur. So you're speaking from a place of privilege and you don't understand my situation. What would you say to that person? Because I'm sure there are many of those people, and that it seems to be the Zambian way, this complaint attitude we have. So what would be your response to that person?
My father's attitude was that the only thing he could give us was an education, nothing else. He didn't believe in capitalism. He didn't believe in this frantic accumulation of wealth. He had no issue with being comfortable, but he didn't accumulate wealth and he didn't want to accumulate wealth. He always said, I'll die with one house and I'll die with one car. And he did. He died with one house and one car, and that car was bought for him by my brother and I. So we had no illusions growing up that we would be inheriting vast quantities of money. We weren't and we didn't. And from A levels, I remember coming back home. And my father saying, oh, you've got a problem. I said, well, what's that? He says, you're not going to university. I said, why? Anglo-American, who had agreed to give me a scholarship to university, had canceled the undergraduate scholarships and had only gone to postgraduate. I said, well, that's a bit unfair. They'd already agreed with me. I've got, you know, 6 months to go to university. He said, well, that's life's not fair. So, okay. So he said, what I'll do for you, I'll do you a favor. You can use the driver. Mr. Tembo can pick you up. You go look for a scholarship. And admittedly, in those days, it was a bit easier. But I had to go. I had to write the letters. There was no computers there. Write the letters, go sit in. Although I first went to Anglo to appeal, but they chased me. All the banks, eventually Lomro gave me a scholarship to go to university. My brother was the same thing. He got a scholarship from the CCM, he had to get it on merit. And he had that belief that, listen, if you're not bright enough to get a scholarship, then you're not really, university might not be the place for you. A bit harsh of an example, but that's how he, that's what he believed in, and that's what he followed through on. So I think from, I used to tease him before he died that he had given my children, his grandchildren, vastly more money than he had given me from the time I was 18 to the time that he died. And I think we totaled that up as a total of $400 in from 1988 to 2012. So you can do the mathematics of what that is that I got out of my father. But where that is most people's presumption is that what you get from your parents in this privilege is actually money. Actually, that's not what I got. So where I answer the question that I've answered it in terms of what people stereotypically I think is where you got this silver spoon in your mouth. What actually the privilege was and the advantage I got was attitude. The attitude, the ability to succeed, the will to succeed. That's what I inherited from both my parents. So, and my mother, you know, again, there's something else we used to tease my father about. Was I was brought up by a single mother. My father was always working. He was always doing it for the country. I said, we didn't argue what you were doing it for. What we were saying is, the end result is I was brought up by a single mother. And the driver, of course, he went to school. So, that's the fact. So, that is where I don't argue that, yes, I got a privilege. From my father, from my mother, and from my grandfather on my father's side, is they gave me a lot of these beliefs, a lot of self-belief, a lot of determination, and that is the privilege. But that doesn't come from wealth or not wealth. It just doesn't. My father grew up, I mean, he learned to read. He didn't have electricity growing up. And I have in my offices the various type of lamps that he used to learn to read. So he grew up in a mine township in Kwekwe, and he succeeded. So money is not what you pass on to children. Money is not what you leave behind. It's your integrity, belief. Those are the privileges, and that doesn't come from your postal code, or your school, or your accent. It doesn't come from that. In fact, some of Zambia's most successful and wealthiest businessmen are not from a background of privilege. So we mustn't underestimate what, how many people here are successful. And success is a question of we are consumed by this MTV culture of what is success, you know, it's my Bentley with spinners. No, success is a very personal thing. It's what motivates you. When you're lying, I had the fortune, I suppose, of being on a deathbed, and you have to ask yourself that question. You have to ask yourself, have I succeeded? And that's really what everyone has got to think about, is that, you know, what is your definition of success? It doesn't have to be about money. Often money will follow. But some of the most successful people, some of the people who are heroes to us all, it wasn't money. Mahatma Gandhi was a very successful lawyer. Mother Teresa was from an extremely wealthy family. And she threw it all up. Do we remember her if she had gone back to Albania and lived this very wealthy and privileged life, traveling around in ships first class? Would we remember her now? Would she have been successful in our eyes? She lived in the poorest slum on the planet. She didn't have high heels with red undersoles. But I challenge anyone to say to her she wasn't successful. Nelson Mandela, 27 years in a prison cell. We see him as successful. Success is not attached to money. And this is what people need to understand, and being driven and moving our country forward is not about this quest for money. And this is where our integrity falls over, because we think that is what we need. But it's not. And we know it, because we only need to look at who our own heroes are. And yes, sometimes it follows. Bill Gates, it followed him. Okay, fine, good on him. But there are many other, I don't know if many people see him as a hero, like they would see other people. But it's that ability to sacrifice for others, to move your country forward. That's generally where we go and see that's a successful person. The question is, how many of us are seeking to be that person? I don't see it in Zambia. I see this quest for money, and this is this MTV culture. And it's eroding our own cultures, and our own cultures are very important, and I think very significant. We should be proud of them. There are certain aspects of them we can also discard along the way, but culture is a moving target. But I think we're discarding some of the most important things about us. My daughter was recently doing some homework, and she was asking me what the differences between Western culture and African cultures are. And I said, it's a very simple answer. Western culture is I and me, and African culture is we and us. But very quickly, we are moving from we and us to I and me. So, my view, what drives me is still us and we. And I think it would be very easy for us to all swing back to that. And when you're talking about we and what the success points are for Zambia, it changes the way we see things and what we want to achieve. And we have to ask ourselves a question that John F. Kennedy asked. What have we done for Zambia? Keep asking, what were the donors are coming, or the government? There's that expression that politicians are actually a reflection of the people. Not that they are the ones who set the tone. They are a reflection of us. So look at our politicians and ask ourselves. You don't have to look at the party. Just look at all the politicians and ask yourselves, is that a reflection you want to see? Because that's where your society is going. And you and we are responsible for that society. Not from privilege, not from money, but from being here. I hope that answers it.
Business is a bumpy road, and we have talked about the successes. And I believe in the enterprises that you are running, there are moments when you face difficulties. And when I looked at the profile, that's one thing that got me to come here. I saw that you have some good skills when it comes to recovery strategies. I want you to explain better on how you have used these recovery strategies in making sure that when you see your business going down, you are able to use those strategies in order to move your business to a level where you want it to be. And the other thing, this concept, the social business concept, whereby you look at the need, what you have been talking about, by striking a balance between the need and your profit margin. Now, what kind of strategy have you been using in order to make sure that you strike such kind of a balance?
Corporate recovery and corporate turnaround has been one of those crucial things. Memorial Park wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for that. Like everyone else, okay, it wasn't year two, but year four was my turning point at Memorial Park. That didn't happen. And it didn't happen for many reasons, but primarily the cultural shift is that people weren't really ready. As Carnegie, one of my favorite entrepreneurs of all time, said, pioneering doesn't pay. And whilst we weren't the first, we were still relatively close to pioneering. And so it's taken about 7 years before we're starting to see something now. And so my investors were there. $5 million had to be, you know, convinced that, hey, listen, don't worry, it's coming. But actually, my brother probably sums it up best. Whilst he's an engineer, he's now more on the finance side, chairman of a bank and NAPSA and all of these things. And me, the banker, is doing the engineering. But he did say, the difference is in business and financing is a very slim difference between success and failure. And one of those keys is, if you've got a payment due and you come the day before to say, listen, I can't make this payment, I need to restructure, that is called restructuring. If you come 24 hours later, a day late, it's called default. And now you're begging for forgiveness. So it is that fine line of facing what you've got to face. People respect you more when you come to them and say, listen, I can't pay. I need 18 months. Oh, 18 months is too long. I said, no, we can put in an escalator. I don't mind paying some interest. But I cannot pay you. And you have to go through everybody. You have to restructure them over a period. And you have to go negotiate in advance of defaulting. If you let all of those things pile up and everyone's piling in, and then you've got a room this full of creditors coming and saying to you, hey, also you owe money. No. But if you're the same room full of people and you've been to them individually, one, they're not going to talk to each other because they've done a deal with me and they'll keep it quiet because they don't want the rest of their customers to know. But they also want their money. And two, is people are generally human. They'll say to you, okay, you've come early, you've given me that respect, you've been honest with me, you've opened your books. And that's the difference with restructuring. And it's not as simple as just saying that. You have to be very technical, you have to have understood your cash flows, you have to understand your projections, there's a lot of technicalities within that. And you also have to understand who's financed you, when's their financial year end, how do they have to report it, how can they restructure it. So there are many things you can do to manage that side of your business, but it's a crucial, crucial side of the business. So good observation. Your second point was about?
About striking a balance between the
profit
and
yeah.
Profit
is necessary for sustainability. If you don't have profit, it's not going to work in the long run. You know. So you have to have profitability. And to raise money, people need to see profitability in return. So that's really where your balance lies, is what is it that people need for their return? And it's understanding that. So in the power sector, it's relatively easy, because there's standard industry norms. But you have to know them, you have to understand them, and you have to negotiate them. Lots of people say, I'm happy, I'll take a 22% IRR at construction. Oh, okay. But it's net of withholding tax, and it's net of insurance, and it's net. When you add that all up, it's 26%. And you tell them, no. First of all, we can start at 20% or 18%, because the industry norm is 18 to 22 at that stage. So instantly they're, this guy knows what he's talking about. We can talk about 18%, but there's some risk. Oh yes, but I know that you invested in this other in Congo, and you accepted a 20% return, so don't tell me country risk, because if you're going to tell me that, I'm going to drop it to 16. You've got a point. But withholding tax, I said, okay, we can do withholding tax, but insurance is your side. That's if you don't understand the technicalities, if you don't understand IRR, they're not going to invest in you. So that electricity, which I'm now going to pay, let's say net or gross of 20% IRR, is the electricity which is going to be used inside them. We are the ones that are going to pay for that electricity. So it's important that I negotiate them down. If I just said, yes, okay, 22%, yes, within the band, I read that somewhere. But actually it worked out at 26%, then we've got much more expensive electricity. So you've got to understand your game. And then you have to say, okay, this is a return, not only to investors, but don't forget, you're an investor. We keep forgetting. Investor seems to be a word for someone coming from outside. It's not. The biggest investors in Zambia are Zambians. It's us. We are investors. And we have to invest. So, what is the return that we need? You know, you've got school fees, you've got children to educate, put through university. And so, you've also got to get a return from them. So that's the balance, because that's actually the true cost. If we were wealthy enough to say, I can afford to give this water treatment plant, because it's a social benefit, and get no return, just give me my money back over 20 years, it's fine. Then we can do that. But most of us are not in that position. We need to start building a return. So you've got to understand your industry, and you've got to understand how to calculate your investment return and the industry returns.
Second question is, how do you take the next step to, from, you know, wanting 10,000 kwacha from the bank to $200 billion, basically? How do you build that confidence in yourself, in your team, and that kind of thing? The final question is on CSR. What is Western Power doing in terms of CSR? Because at the end of the day, as you say, we're all investors in this, and we need to give back to the community. Thanks.
I was in Egypt recently speaking at a conference, and I was said, oh, there's some solar opportunities in Tunisia, why don't you take those on? And right now it's not something that I feel that I can dedicate myself to, because there's one too much to do here. And you know, I've taken a big chunk which I have to focus on, I have to get it right. So in terms of further opportunities, there are further opportunities in power. We have already started a company called Western Solar, looking to do between 100 and 200 megawatts in, again, southern part of Western Province, which is the best solar irradiation in Zambia. So there are some solar and hydro opportunities, some perhaps wind opportunities, which I'd like to get going. In terms of cemeteries, maybe one in the copper belt, so they don't feel unfair that they've got the same product, but we'll see. Maybe I'll ask Manasseh to be my partner on that one. So, yeah, my inspiration remains Zambia. You know, the more I can do to get Zambia forward as an individual, the more I can get people to join me or me to join them in moving Zambia forward, the better place for my kids and my grandkids to live. You know, I don't want this. We've had a big exodus. A lot of my friends I grew up with, they don't live here anymore. You know, I think that's a shame. I think we need to have an environment where things have improved. You returned. I remember telling you I was very pleased that you'd returned. You brought back skill sets, you brought back, and we need to make Zambia a place people feel that they want to return, and there's an ability. You know, access to finance would be another one. A lot of the problem with Zambians, or anyone, but particularly Zambians abroad, especially in the West, is they've got too many Congolese to leave and come here where we've got poor cash flows and difficulties. So, the more I can do of that, that's really my inspiration and my drive right now is within the borders of Zambia. But it doesn't mean that later on I can't go out. Your second question was about confidence. A lot of what I try and do is to confidence about self-belief. I mean, and it's difficult. It's you know, again, the fine line between confidence and arrogance. But you have to believe in yourself. And often that comes from seeing people succeed and having examples. And we don't have enough of that here. They're there, but we don't have enough of them. A lot of fellow entrepreneurs, some elders have come to me and said, you boy, why are you going talking so much? We're talking these entrepreneur things. You know, there's PhD in this country. And I said, yes, I know, it's easier to keep quiet and keep in the background, put someone forward as a chairman, you know, as long as I've got the shares, you can have whatever title you want, we'll give it something. But it's easier to do that, and a lot of people in Zambia do that. But I think that's doing us a disservice, which is why I agree. We'll see in time whether they're right or I'm right, but it's why I agree to put my head above the parapet, is to try and help build people's confidence. Zambians are very skilled. Anyone who comes in, we've got an attitude problem amongst ourselves. We can talk about that, but we're skilled. And people come here and feel we're skilled and feel we're friendly. We're losing some of that friendliness, which is a pity, because it's a strength. When people feel happy, they in a friendly environment, they're more likely to invest. So we're tending to get this bitterness that it's someone else's fault. But confidence, a lot of people have it. A lot of people, Zambians have that self-belief. Sometimes too much too soon. I was one of them. I'll be a millionaire by 30. It doesn't work like that. You learn in life that things take longer than you expect. And it's fine. But everyone will go through that learning curve. But we've just got to believe in the end game. I think the biggest problem here and the biggest issue is we have a lack of planning. My grandfather is the one who taught me that. And I plan, my brother plans for our grandchildren. We don't plan for ourselves, we don't plan for our children. What are we doing to impact our grandchildren? So that's a, you know, 40, 50 year horizon. In terms of planning and what you do and where the result comes from. So, you know, if the power project that I'm starting and the subsequent ones come through 10 years, 15 years from now, for me, that's way ahead of schedule because I've got a 50-year horizon. That also helps give you some confidence in terms of what is it that you're trying to achieve and look for. If you're trying to achieve, hey, me, I want the life for myself, okay, that's fine. It's your goal. No one can judge you for that. But then you've got to set out, what do you want at the end of this month, at the end of this year, and what are your targets? And then you compare yourself. Targets always move. But if you don't have them, then you don't know how far you're off them and why you didn't achieve them. So at the end of the year, I want to be earning 30,000 kwacha a month. And at the end of the year, you're earning 28. I say, hey, okay, I didn't make it, but I was close. At the end of the year, you're earning 10,000. But that's because, you know, XYZ fell through. There's a reason for that, but I can overcome that. I'll readjust my target, move it for another 6 months, because those issues will be resolved by then. So that helps build up your confidence, because you're able to counter. If you set a 30,000 per month target and you're earning 1,000 per month at the end of the year, revise your targets. It's that simple. So you, and that helps. That's what helps give you your confidence, because you know where you're going. Too often, if you're not planning, you're not thinking, what is there to be confident about? Have I done well? You know, you get your first Corolla and say, hey, I've arrived. Then, you know, you start thinking immediately, yeah, no, the next guy I want is that one. But if you planned out where you're going to go from Corolla to Bentley, okay, you have your plan, that'll help give you confidence. But we don't plan, we don't look into the future, it's now. Even all this issue around side deals and all of those things, you know, too many people lose their job because they did a side deal for, you know, $100. You lose your job and lose just in the next year, you've lost, you know what, $20,000-$30,000 worth of income because of a $100 deal. You know, you're not thinking. Someone comes and says, hey, what's wrong with you? Even if someone came and offered you $20,000, you think, hey, that's a year's income. Why am I going to risk everything for 1 year? But if you're thinking about this month, you say, oof, $20,000, let's do the deal. And that is where I think a lot of these issues on confidence and things come from. So CSR, I don't like that word. I don't. But nonetheless, the context of CSR, I believe in partnership. So with Western Power and Western Solar, we've partnered with local communities. We've had some other developments where we're struggling with local communities, property developments. But we always try and partner with local communities, and they get a share. We don't like to call it a free carry because it's not a free carry. They've got to contribute. They've got to contribute on sensitization. They've got to contribute on the acquisition of land. They've got to contribute to the acquisition of water rights. They've got to participate in environmental impact assessments. And they've got to bring all the people together. That's an input. And for that, we give a share. And from that share comes a return, a long-term return. I mean, a power station is comfortably 100 years plus. And so we are working with the local communities there as partners, not as CSR. But the CSR impact of, if you like, we could talk about it as we've given these shares so it can go into this trust, and then we'll put the trust and we'll blow some balls. You know, we're not coming with that attitude. We're Zambians. They put in their contribution. I don't want someone coming to me and telling me how I must spend my share. You know, that's my money. So if I want to spend it, I want now CSR, and in this instance, we've got financiers to deal with. We won't be seeing those returns, but the community will. The community, we've negotiated special circumstances for them. And therefore, the international financiers are also going to have some rules on governance and so on and so forth. As far as we're concerned, your money, do what you want with it. But internet, we have to strike that balance between that and the international financiers that want real strict control, accountability, and so on. But nonetheless, it will go to benefit the community, and the communities will decide what's best for them. It's not for me to come and say, yeah, let's drill a borehole here. They might not want a borehole. They might want a boat. Well, they should decide what's best, and the funding available in their trust, which is their money, they will decide how to use it. All we've said to the financiers is, we will concede that you can govern in terms of accountability, that the money went onto that boat, and it was a $1,000 boat, not a $100,000 boat that they bought. And there's the receipts, there's the tenders, there's a... So there'll be a process for all of that. But the community is generally happy with that. They were happy for it to be, the money to be accountable. So I'm not a fan of CSR, but that's what we are doing with the local communities. And we foresee huge, massive impacts from their returns on their dividends and royalties on.
I don't know much about Western Power, so it would be interesting if you do have time to just briefly, if you could just say what kind of projects that you're engaged in. Obviously power projects, but in terms of what are you doing and where are you doing it and how are you doing it? Is it hydro, is it solar, is it thermal? Just those brief details. My questions are two questions. The first is tied to corruption. How do you deal with corruption in your businesses, and do you have any proven strategies on how you guard against this risk for your businesses? Then secondly, and on a more practical note, if I'm a first time and I come to you and ask, say, look, I have a bit of money, or let's say not more than 100,000 kwacha, and I'm looking at some areas of need, what two areas of need would you think one could venture into if they're thinking of business in Zambia?
Yes. We take water out of the Zambezi, run it along a 3-kilometer canal, push it through turbines and drop it back in. So non-consumptive water use. It'll cost about $220 million to build. To put it into context, Western Province, which is Eastern Sioma in Ngonya Falls, in terms of developmental impact, access to power is crucial. If a farmer in Sioma right now wants to plow, wants a water pump, he has to drive 150 kilometers to get fuel in the back of his truck and drive back. So it's a round trip of, let's say, 200 to 300 kilometers just to fuel his water pump and his tractor. You know, because you can't have a filling station there with no electricity. So the development impact we feel will be massive on Western Province, and we're very pleased about that. So that's is that enough on the scheme?
Okay. Yeah.
Your first question was
corruption.
Well, as I said, I mean, Jesse, this week, we must understand as Zambians how much corruption, both public and private sector, and let's not pretend it's just the government, it's public and private sector. Corruption is killing us. And you always hear this. Magufuli has come into Tanzania. He's been there 3 months. Tanzania's growth rate has gone from 4% to 7.something%. It's effectively doubled in one quarter. What has he done? Only remove corruption. And he's doubled the growth rate. Just by removing corruption. Tanzania's ports, I believe, I should be careful you're publishing these things, I believe after that hospital incident, they heard that Magufuli would be visiting them next. The port in Dar generally minimum 3 month delay, and lots of negotiations with the counterparts at the port authorities, which is why most people said, let's go to Durban or even Bairau. When they heard the visit was coming, it took them 3 days to clear the 3 month backlog, and there's absolutely no backlog in Dar port. Everyone now wants to come through Dar to bring their things in, because it's the most efficient port. What's that impact have? Straight into the bottom line. And that development, that growth rate, is what educates our children, it's what gives us healthcare. So everyone who believes that taking a little bit aside from the company, no, I'm not taking from the government, I'm taking from the person who supplied the goods. It's from his margin, not from the government's margin. No. Actually, the government would have been able to get that thing less. If I'm willing to supply this bottle of water for 10 kwacha to the government, and I'm selling it for 15, but giving you 5, well, actually, that's our loss. And it's because of corruption. Corruption slows things down, public and private sector. Corruption in banks, trying to get credit, all areas. It slows things down necessarily. And that's why Tanzania's growth rate in one quarter of Magufuli being there. No new investment, no new, just an attitude. And that is erasing corruption, is double its growth rate. And you will see Tanzania's growth rate, if it continue to grow. So, that's the corruption. Yeah, that third one.
Well, on corruption, there was any helpful strategies for an entrepreneur to deal with.
Oh, yes. Okay. You always bump into it. My view is, don't get involved in it. I would rather slow down my projects than get involved in it. And especially with international finances. Again, it's an integrity issue. Once you do it, once you're tempted into it, it'll come back to bite you in some form or another. You see the disclaimers now that I have to sign on this $200 million we're raising. You know, if I give someone lunch money, that's it. They can take all my shares, it's brutal. But also, you become known for that one. It doesn't get involved in corruption. And the corrupt people on the other side, what do? They slow your project down. They keep trying to slow you down. So eventually, you give something. Or you're tempted to cut a corner with an environmental impact assessment. Or it will catch up with you. So as painful as it is, and believe me, it's painful. I've suffered with them. I've lost projects because of corruption. So big projects, commercial shopping centers in Lusaka. And it's better that I do that. So my view is, yes, it's painful, but the more of us who just say, sorry, it's not going to happen, the better our country will become. Corruption is a two-way street. So you can't just say, no, he's corrupt, even though you gave him something to. No, you're also corrupt. The giver and the taker are corrupt. No, personally, I don't want to be corrupt. So, unfortunately, my answer is, you just have to struggle through it. And you get respect in the end, even within government. They'll say, okay, we'll process.
And the last question on any one or two areas of need that someone can engage in. Well, you could take your time to answer it after if it's on the spot.
It's a simple question. Need is everywhere. What you need is different from what I need. But need is everywhere. And that's why I'm saying is that Zambia is a fantastic place for entrepreneurs. Fantastic. Because we have need and we don't have to reinvent the wheel. We don't have to reinvent it. We do have to invent some pride in local products and buy Zambian. We do have to all be involved in that. You know, many people I see talking, your Woolworths or something, or big South African brand comes in here, and people are saying, this is more expensive than the one in Joburg. No, not in Joburg, I'll buy it. Come on. They're paying local taxes, they're employing local people. Support them, even if it's a foreign brand, support it. And within there, ask them, do you have any products that are made in Zambia? Maybe the t-shirt made in Zambia is not as good as the American mega brand, but buy it. These boys here, they've got excellent products. I have my children wear their products right in front of you. T-shirts, skateboards, all kinds of things. Support them. So the need is there. What our problem is not the need. The problem is, are we willing to support that? If there was a Zambian ketchup and then they've got Heinz, which one are you going to buy? So that's a bigger picture issue. But in terms of the need, yes, there's a need for a Zambian ketchup. There's a need for absolutely everything. So find a need that you will enjoy working on and that will give you satisfaction. Apply the detail and the discipline, your return will come.
My question to you, Sipho, is why do you think is the main reason why joint ventures fail, especially international, where somebody doesn't know Zambia and wants to get into the market through you? What do you think is the main reason those fail?
There is no large global business which hasn't got multiple partners in it. Even that Goti, whilst he's the face, you will find he has partnered with people. Not that I know, but I can guarantee you it. Richard Branson doesn't own 100% of his outfits. In fact, it's probably under 50. All of these, you might have a face of a business, but for the partnerships is what creates it. And the reason for that is, and I learned this in the consulting world, Arthur Anderson and Accenture had an expression of the partnership team in each unit. Together, they should make a great partner. Because everyone has particular strengths. You don't have to like the partner. You don't have to want to go and drink with him, or hang out with him, or go on family holidays together. You can actually dislike him. But when it comes to applying ourselves to the business, they have a skill that you don't. And that is why together you would make a great team to deal with issues. Someone is front-facing, talking, selling products. Someone else is back-facing, getting all the invoicing, the accounts, all of those things done. And without both of them, the international partner is not interested. He comes and says, great, you've got a great product, everything is working fantastic, can I see your books? Okay, let me talk to my cousin, maybe he can do something quickly for you, I'll present them to you in 2 weeks. The partner you dislike so much, because he's a very different person to you, is the one saying, no, no problem, come to my office, I'll give it to you straight away. Bang, now you've got a deal. But the problem is, with all partnerships, international and local, comes down to when there's no money in the business, everyone is together. But as soon as the money starts to flow, memories start to change. And so you've got to be meticulous in documenting your partnerships and what the actual agreements are and what the differentiate between working. So let's say you and I made a partnership, right? And we both contribute 20,000 kwacha each into the business. But I'm off doing Western Power and all my other things, and you're working on the business. And you don't have a salary. But we're not, both of us aren't getting anything out. Suddenly, bingo, Google come and say, hey, I like that app. Here's $20 million. And there I come back from Western Province saying, hey, where's my 10? You're going to be sick. You're going to be saying, hey, you weren't even here other than your money. But I'm the one who was sweating day in, day out for all these years on my product. Pay yourself for those. Differentiate between the people who work and get paid. Accrue your salary. Because then maybe you've accrued, even if it's $100,000 or $200,000 you've accrued in salary. You know you've been paid for your work, and now we're getting the split of this giant return based on the money we put in. That's why you'll get slightly more than me, because you've been compensated for your work. But if you don't document that, then the problems come when money comes. So shareholder agreements, and especially within those, the divorce clauses, how are you going to separate? So your company does get valued at $20 million. Google even gives an offer. And you say, nothing, I'm not selling it now. I'm going to sell it when it gets $100 million, like WhatsApp. That guy lived in poverty for years and cashed out a billionaire. He made the right decisions. But if I had been his partner, and someone had made a $20 million offer, not a $2 billion offer, you know, I said, I want to wait, I'm taking it now. So you have to buy me out. Where are you going to get $10 million to buy me out? So your divorce clauses have to be very carefully structured to say, you know, it can only be a third-party buyout, or you have to go out at the same time, or who buys who out, or rights of first refusal. So all of those issues have to be documented and signed. So whoever's unhappy when it comes time, because memories have shifted and money is flowing in, you say, yeah, this is your signature, yeah, and you accept, hey, okay, I was down, I shouldn't have said that. But you accept that's what you came in with, that was the idea, and if you've lost out, you can renegotiate in good faith, and if the other guy says no, tough luck, that's what we signed up for. And that integrity of that document, and everyone agrees, we disagree 10 years from now, fine. So that is the crucial part on partnerships, international and local. Document what you've agreed. You know, make sure what you've agreed, the shareholding split, the money is accounted for, and it's also reflected at background. Because we go into this joint venture, we've got the shareholder agreement, everything is there, and then Google come with $20 million, and we go to Pakram, oh, I forgot to put it. It's my company. Be meticulous in your detail. Not because you distrust someone, but just it's the right thing to do. You've got to keep all of those things documented. Get your governance structures right.
based on that background that I've said, I want to ask something in terms of you coming from a corporate background. How did you manage that move? I don't know if you ever got in a situation where you try to do business while at the same time you're working. And in particular where your capital isn't that much, you're trying to keep your costs as very low as possible. So you can't necessarily hire the most qualified, highly competent, expensive resource. So you get pressure from your corporate environment, but you get pressure from your business as well. What's your advice in terms of how a person can handle that? Another lighter question really is, what's a typical day for a millionaire? I mean, you run several ventures. What do you do when you wake up? What time do you wake up? What time do you sleep? How often do you, how long, how many hours do you wake? You know, so often we see people arrive at 8:05 and 16:55, they're out. I mean, what are the attributes that one needs to have?
The way to keep costs down in that business, if you like, was I would, lunch break wasn't sitting eating lunch, it was getting in the car, rushing to the site. There was less traffic in those days, it was easier. Get there, run around, ask what's going on, knock down that wall, make it straight, get these tiles in, rush back, come back at 5, spend an hour, go back to the office, finish off my work, come back to the site. So, I also did some consulting, which means that when I finished all of that, I would then spend an hour at home, and then I'll start consulting. On average, I spent from the age of 22, 23, when I had my heart attacks 8 years ago, I slept about 2 to 4 hours a night. Your life is split into three sections. 8 hours of sleep, 8 hours for yourself, and 8 hours for work. That's what you have. Now, if you want to increase in one, you have to take away from the other. It's that simple. So, mine was very simple. I needed to increase work, I took away from the others, and sleep was my favorite. I robbed from sleep, but I paid that price. Sleep is very important for you. So, one of the hardest things I had to learn to do was I had to relearn to sleep. It's been a very difficult process to learn that. And whilst I can now sleep, the problem is time is even harder to juggle because I don't have that safety valve of stealing it from sleep. So that was really how I dealt with those issues. And whatever your business is on the side, one thing I made sure of was I never ever took from my employer. Never took from my employer. They paid me for the time I was there. And so I gave them that time plus some. And in between is where I would fit in my businesses, not to affect them. So, you know, that I thought was the right thing to do. And it also taught me how much it takes to go into the entrepreneurial world. So the average day of a highly indebted person is now, I wake up at 6 o'clock, watch a bit of news, take my children to school. It's an important time for me to spend with them in the morning, although, you know, as they're teenagers, they're often half asleep, but loud music and playing around usually gets them up, but it's a good time. It's an important time to spend with them. A tradition my father also had with me, when he was in the country, he would take us to work, so I followed that tradition. From there, I go to the gym. It's 7:30, I'm roughly at the gym, for about an hour. I then go from the gym, spend roughly an hour and a half at Memorial Park, going through all the issues, working with the management team there. From there, I go to my office, I don't like having meetings in the morning, so the rest of the morning is really to catch up on time. One of the things I'm concentrating on is allocating time to organize myself. I used to fit organization in between, and now I actually have at least an hour. I've got two very good assistants who come in. They try and keep me on time. They try and go through all my to-dos. I'm very happy this year that I've pushed a lot of the to-dos and delegated it to them, so they're looking very stressed at the moment. And I can ask them, have you done this, and this in the morning? So, lunch, not always, but usually half an hour for lunch. If I've had too late a night, I will go home. One of the things I have done is my office is next to my home, so lunch is literally a walk. I walk next door. And that's my sleep safety valve now. If I'm tired, I haven't slept enough, then I'll use that anywhere from 15 minutes to 1 hour of sleep. But usually my discipline of sleep is enough that I don't need to use that. So I go home maybe half an hour for lunch if I go. Then afternoon meeting starts. So meetings are generally from 2 all the way through to, I try and stop them at 5. Last night they ended about 9, for example. But afternoon is for my meetings. 6 and 7, again, is back to administration. 7 onwards is now my most email, my productive time. Last year, my 13-year-old, or she's 14 at the time, I got home, I came home about 9 o'clock, 21 hours, and she looked at me and she says, what are you doing home so early? And I was like, well, actually, for us, maybe it's early, but in the real world, 21 is not early. But generally, my target now is to try and get home around 22. Preferably 21, but 21 is still a bit difficult for me. And then try and go to sleep by 23. Usually it's 24, I fall asleep. So I try and keep my minimum of 6 hours sleep, but 7 hours is ideal. So that's roughly my day, and that's Monday to Sunday.
We're done. It's been amazing. Sipho, I just want to say thank you so much for coming and just sharing your journey. I think we've all taken away something, and one day when we caught, we should say, I got this from Sipho Phiri, you know? Let's give credit where it's due. Thank you so much for coming. It's really been an honor.